John William Coltrane, born September 23, 1926, died July 17, 1967, was an American jazz saxophonist and composer, working in the bebop and hard bop idioms early in his career. Coltrane helped pioneer the use of modes and was at the forefront of free jazz. He led at least 50 recording sessions and appeared on many albums by other musicians, including trumpeter Miles Davis and pianist Thelonious Monk. Over the course of his career, Coltrane's music took on an increasingly spiritual dimension, and he remains one of the most influential saxophonists in music history. He received many posthumous awards, including canonization by the African Orthodox Church, and a Pulitzer Prize in 2007. His second wife was pianist Alice Coltrane, and their son Ravi Coltrane is also a saxophonist. During the early 60s, critics were divided in their estimation of Coltrane, who had a radically altered style. Audiences too were perplexed. In France, he was booed during his final tour with Miles Davis. In 1961, Downbeat magazine called Coltrane and Eric Dolphy players of anti-jazz in an article that bewildered and upset the musicians. Coltrane admitted some of his early solos were based mostly on technical ideas. Furthermore, Dolphy's angular, voice-like playing earned him a reputation as a figurehead of the New Thing, also known as free jazz, a movement led by Ornette Coleman, which was criticized by some jazz musicians, including Miles Davis. But as Coltrane's style developed, he was determined to make every performance a whole expression of one's being. Coltrane famously said, as quoted by YouDiscoverMusic.com, "I start in the middle and move both directions at once. One positive thought produces millions of positive vibrations. I think I was first awakened to musical exploration by Dizzy Gillespie. It was through their work that I began to learn more about musical structures and the more theoretical aspects of music. I'd like to point out to people the divine in a musical language that transcends words. I want to speak to their souls. The real risk is not changing. I have to feel that I'm after something. If I make money, fine. But I'd rather be striving. It's the striving, man. That's what I want. I never even thought about whether or not they understand what I'm doing. The emotional reaction is all that matters. As long as there's some feeling of communication, it isn't necessary that it be understood. You can play a shoestring if you're sincere. All a musician can do is to get closer to the sources of nature and so feel that he is in communion with the natural laws. I want to be a force for real good. In other words, I know that there are bad forces. Forces that bring suffering to others and misery to the world. But I want to be the opposite force. I want to be the force which is truly for good. Anytime you play your horn, it helps you. If you get down, you can help yourself, even in a rock and roll band. My goal is to live the truly religious life and express it through my music. If you can live it, there's no problem about the music, because it's part of the whole thing. I've found you've got to look back at the old things and see them in a new light. Down the rules. It's the feeling that counts. You can play all 12 notes in your solo anyway." A Love Supreme, recorded 1964, is one of Coltrane's best-known and best-selling works, and it contributed to the spiritual cult that grew up around him. But it is significant on musical grounds alone, for in this piece, Coltrane improvises with extraordinary compositional clarity, using a minimum of extraneous notes, and it introduces an effective technique for spontaneously translating words to music. As quoted from A Love Supreme, Improvisation as Composition by Lewis Porter, 1985. In the 33-minute epic, Coltrane wrote a long poem after a spiritual experience that saw him coming clean, cold turkey, off of a bad heroin addiction. He sang the words through his saxophone solo, using different scales and modulation to create a piece that uses all 12 chromatic notes of the Western scale. Archie Shepp commented on this phenomenon. One of the many things Train accomplished was the breakthrough into the concept that a jazz musician need not, could not, be limited to a solo lasting a few minutes. Coltrane demonstrated that a man could play much longer, and that in fact, it was an imperative of his conception to improvise at great length. To do this, Coltrane combined his fascination of astrology, spirituality, and physics to come up with a unique method of harmonic progression, now known as the Coltrane Changes. In his search for a musical spirituality, he combined the idea of the Holy Trinity and the most common rhythmical changes in jazz, the 2-5-1, to form a cyclical progression that modulates between three keys, each one a major third apart. This can be heard best on his 1959 recording, Giant Steps, released in 1960 on Atlantic Records, the current song we're listening to. It is widely recognized as the most difficult song to improvise over in modern jazz. It has three key centers, B, G, and E flat, and is insanely fast at 290 BPM. Coltrane's sound is the sound of the joy of discovery, the sound of surprise, as critic Whitney Balliet once famously described the essence of jazz. To his friends, Coltrane was a marked man, at least after A Love Supreme. He already knew back then that his sounds were shaping the jazz of his times, and he suffered from this responsibility. He saw himself too strongly as a ceaseless seeker to be able to enjoy the fact that the whole jazz world now praised each of his statements as the last word. In answer to the question whether there would ever be an end to the development that had already led him through half a dozen different ways of playing since the mid-50s and the Miles Davis Quintet, Coltrane told Nat Hentoff, "You just keep going all the way, as deep as you can. You keep trying to get right down to the crux." It's widely noted that pianist Tommy Flanagan almost struggled to comprehend the extremely quick modulation in his improvised playing for this track, as can be heard in the sharp, jagged style displayed on the recording. Now, it is considered a rite of passage for professional jazz musicians of all instruments. Listening to Coltrane's recorded performances, we hear a composer at work, shaping, developing, and connecting musical ideas, while attempting, often successfully, to keep the musical whole in perspective. What makes this special is that the composer is outstanding, especially in the world of jazz.